Hi, I'm Janelle Pugmire with the Daily Herald, and we're here with a very familiar face, George Stewart, former mayor and former city council member, who is trying to take it on again with the city council and see what you can do for a second time. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All
I can't
right.
believe I'm doing it.
I can't believe you are either, George. How old are you these days?
I'm 75.
My goodness.
People have said I'm older, and I go, come on now, 75 is old enough.
75. Well, anybody that can do 75 in a council, we're going to give you a nod for that. How's
Thank
that?
Thank you.
What we want you to do, George, is talk a little bit about yourself to the folks here, maybe a couple of minutes. Just tell us a little bit about yourself, and then I'm going to lay you with some pretty good questions.
Okay. Well, I'm George Stewart. I have a wonderful family. My wife, Joanna, we have 11 children, 44 grandchildren, and 3 great-grandchildren. And so it's been a wonderful life that we've had. We moved to Provo because it was Provo. I went to Arizona State University, and BYU was not, they were the enemy in the WAC. But we wanted to raise our family in a place where we felt good about the environment and everything, and we moved here in 1978 and have been here ever since. Our kids were educated in the Provo schools. I've been a business executive most of my career. I started in sales and moved my way up. I was president of the Dealer Service Division of Automatic Data Processing. ADP is a $7 billion company now.
Wow.
So I've had a lot of experience in business. But quite frankly, the most enjoyable business experience I had was being mayor of Provo. Because in Provo, we have the strong mayor form of government where the mayor is the CEO of the city. And therefore, you get to run a $150 million organization. We have great, great employees in Provo. The energy department was my favorite department, because it was a big business and contributes greatly to the city still. In fact, over $7 million a year comes into the general fund budget from the energy revenues that we have, rather than going to stockholders. The stockholders in Provo Power are the citizens of Provo. I also served on the city council. We only ran for one term as mayor because we wanted to serve church missions. And we were able to serve in Argentina, the Navajo Reservation, and also Mexico City. So that's been a great part of our life also. So I speak fluent Spanish. It took me 4 missions to do it.
Not Arizona?
Well, I use it in Arizona because there's a lot of Hispanics.
That's where I learned my Spanish, was in Arizona.
¿Vamos a hablar español?
Sí.
Qué bueno. Okay, we won't speak Spanish.
That's right. But can we just start in with some of these questions?
Are you
excited for this candidacy? Let me ask this one. Provo in the last few years has been on a lot of lists. They've been number 1, 2, or 3 in jobs, opportunities, place to live, that kind of thing. What list would you like to see Provo on as the number 1, and why?
The best place in the world to live and the best family city in the United States and the world. So those are the two most important to me. The quality of life that we have in Provo and the family life that we have in Provo, that's encouraged, not discouraged.
Great. Okay, that kind of just goes into what my next question is. Because I've seen this on your flyers and on your website. Both of the candidates, you and Karina, are talking about maintaining Provo's quality of life. What specifically do you think Provo needs to do that it's not doing right now to improve and maintain the quality of life for its residents?
Well, we need to maintain single-family neighborhoods. And they're encroached on by rentals, where people want to have extra income by renting out their basement, which is against the zoning in an R1 neighborhood. And the complaint I have more often received during my campaigning is the zoning enforcement. And it's hard. No one wants to enforce the zoning, but it's the most important thing to maintain the quality of the single family neighborhoods. Because we're a college town, we're a 2 college town. And so people want to rent, and it's desirable from a financial standpoint, but if you move into an R1 neighborhood, you should know that you can't rent out your basement. And that enforcement has been lacking, I think, due to perhaps funding. So I would encourage the administration, if I'm on the council, to be more vigilant in enforcing the zoning ordinances.
Okay.
And we also, to maintain a quality of life, we need the revenue coming in. So we need more retail.
Okay. Let me ask you this next question, George, because that leads right into something that you've had on your websites and on some of your brochures and things.
I'm glad
and
you read my literature.
I did. I had to find out who you're all about, because one of the things you've talked about is economy and budgets. And that's always been a priority for Provo residents. That's a big concern, is the economic base and then the city budget. So what concerns you specifically about the current city budgets and our economic base in Provo?
Well, first of all, the long-term trajectory of our budget wasn't positive. I was asked to serve on a budget committee for the city council because the revenue coming in was not going to equal the expenses going out. Mm-hmm. One of the things we've looked at in the last year on that committee is fees. Many fees that we have, we're not charging even what it costs to have the direct services given, much less the indirect costs. And so we've recommended to the council that some of the fees be increased to cover at least the cost of the service that we're giving. So that's a big concern. Our nation is in trouble financially, mm-hmm. and that can affect us. We have to be very careful and be good guardians of the dollars that come in.
Mm-hmm. So maintaining the quality of life could also include them having to pay for that quality of life by helping with those fees and offsetting some of the ones that are being paid for, subsidized.
That's
by
right.
the city.
And the second greatest revenue source is sales tax. Actually, it's the first grade. Property tax is the second. And our sales tax hasn't increased as rapidly as I hoped it would when we had the mall come in, because we've lost some retail establishments. Plumtree, look at Plumtree. It's a tragedy that we lost Shopko and then nothing's there to replace it. East Bay, we were going to have Target, Petco, and a lot of other stores come in because of the recession. That didn't happen. And so we have those areas around the old Sears store. That's empty now. Well, it has the power department in it temporarily, but that's going to be vacant, with all kinds of establishments around it that are underutilized are vacant. Mm-hmm. So all those things need to be addressed. When I was the mayor, we brought the mall. We brought Riverwoods, we revived, although it was a revision, Academy Square, uh-huh. and we've had no major retail come in the city since that time. So I would like to work closely with Mayor Curtis, we're good friends, mm-hmm. and seeing that we establish a stronger retail base, because we have to go out of the city, which causes pollution, to shop for many of the things that we need on a daily basis.
Okay. All right, so let's talk a little bit about, you said you like Mayor Curtis. He's a pretty nice guy. People seem to like him, about 95% rating
right.
here. The city council and the administration have varied roles in running the city. Are their roles complementary and in sync with one another, or does it need to improve? And as a council member, how would you improve the role of the council right now?
Well, the council needs to be a separate branch of government, separate but equal. And some people think that if you have any kind of disagreement, that you shouldn't express that publicly. That's the purpose of having separate but equal branches of government, to disagree but not be disagreeable. Mm-hmm. So I think the council needs to be a strong voice. We're 7 in the council versus 1 in the mayor. 8 people make a better decision than 1 person by himself. I'm sure the mayor would appreciate that. I've had both roles. I've been on the council, I've been the mayor. And I think that you can work together, but you should work separately, but not be disagreeable. When I say separately, the council needs to establish and take its role, and the mayor needs to establish and take his role. But they're different roles. The council ultimately makes a decision on the budget. People say it's the mayor's budget. No, it's not the mayor's budget, I'm sorry. It's the council's budget. The mayor submits a budget that the council then has to approve. And the council's two main responsibilities are, number one, budget, number two, land use. And so they need to be a strong voice for those. Mm-hmm. And if they have disagreements, it's okay. As long as you're not disagreeable, it's okay to discuss it in public. I think the public is better informed when the discussion is in public rather than just in private. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question?
It does. I'm hoping that the residents who are watching this will understand what you're trying to say. And I do believe that you have delineated the difference between the council and the administration. But I want to go back to the economy This is the last one. This is going to be a hard question of the day, so I want you to put your thinking cap on, okay?
I will.
You as the mayor, you touted bringing in the only big economic building sales tax base businesses, the Proletown Center Mall. Let's talk a little bit about that. I'm concerned about that, and I think a lot of residents are. It almost looks like a wasteland out there right now.
But it's still profitable.
It's profitable, but I want to ask you this question.
Okay.
When you brought in the mall, there was a contract that was signed with Sizzling Platters, that is the owner. Okay. Sizzling Platter that owns Red Robin. And that contract does not allow for outgrowth. And what I mean by outgrowth, we're looking at University Place now in Orem that has pads on the outside where there's new restaurants and things to revitalize. A mall typically needs to be revitalized every 17 to 20 years.
And it's been that long.
And it's 20 years now since you've been mayor, and nothing really is happening or going with the mall. We're grateful for Sears, we're grateful for Penny's and Dillard's and the big anchor stores.
And Home Depot.
And Home Depot that's out there. But I would like to know from you, as a new city council member, looking at that economic base that you as a mayor put down there in Provo, what can you do or what will you do to bring back and revitalize the Provo Town Center, working with either the owners, or how are you going to help that huge tax base that you're so proud of come back? Because we now have a huge change going on with the Woodbury Corporation in Orem. So I'm just wondering, you knew everything from the get-go, from the beginning, and now we're in that 20-year cycle, and it needs to have some help down there. It's almost like you said, we didn't get the Target, we didn't get a Petco because of the 2008 recession.
Right.
And we're almost looking a little bit like a wasteland down there, and I would like to know what you will do as a council member to help build the economic base in that area of the city.
Support the mayor. It's really his responsibility. It would not be proper for our individual council members to interfere with his work with economic development and working with the owners of the mall. We could be supportive and helpful, and if he'd like, I'd love to go with him or with the economic development team to show the support of the total city. Mm-hmm. That agreement with Red Robin wasn't during my term. Mm-hmm. That was later. Red Robin came after I was out of office. And so I think it would be, we need to develop more businesses around the mall to draw people in. You have Sam's Club, but if we'd have got Pepco and Target, it would have brought more traffic into the mall area. I think the most important thing for the mall is to develop around the mall to bring additional traffic in.
And so when you're saying it's the mayor's job, I would like to know what suggestions you'd give the mayor on how to, you know, make that a better economic place, because certainly we've been looking at downtown Provo. We all know downtown Provo is the it place for Provo.
Right.
And I know the residents know that. And yes, we did lose Shopko because Shopko themselves pulled out. And there are things that are happening there.
And we lost Kmart, which is close to the mall.
Yeah, Kmart is there. And so we are going through this hard change of, do we big bucks? Do we do the cultural, you know, kitschy thing here in Provo? We're deciding who we are, but one of the biggest things that we have that is one of the flagships from your administration is that Provo Town Center. So I was just wondering how, as council members, and they talk about it, how you as a council member could help the mayor, whichever mayor it is. Maybe it's not Curtis, maybe he's gone in a couple of years, I don't know, but this is one of the big areas that needs to be retouched, and I just want to know what you'd like to see out there. Tell me some of the things you'd like to see.
It would
there.
Be presumptuous for me to know what's happening, because I've asked John.
Mm-hmm.
He hasn't told me.
Okay, that's fair.
And so there's a lot of things that are happening that I think will be good for Provo around the mall. That's what I hear rumor-wise.
Mm-hmm.
So again, I think that's the best thing we can do is be supportive of the development that was going to go south of Novell. That needs to be revitalized. That needs to be brought in again.
Over at the golf course area.
The golf course. Mm-hmm. I mean, we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars preparing for that, and then it didn't come. So So I think, again, that's the biggest thing we can do as the council, be supportive of a development in that area that would then enhance the traffic flow into our mall. The mall is owned by a private entity. All we can do is make suggestions and be helpful. I don't want to do what Orem's done and give great subsidies. Mm-hmm. Orem has gotten a lot of the business away from Provo because of giving subsidies, which has hurt their tax base. You know, they have all this retail, but they're hurting financially because they've given so much of it away. So I think all I can do, I wish I could do more, but all I can do is be supportive of the mayor and the administration and the Economic Development Department and helping them.
Okay, so we'll watch for you to be supportive of the mayor as we try to go out and get economic base at the
mall
and other
places.
Well,
that's the council's role, is to be supportive in those kinds of activities.
Okay.
Because we shouldn't presume that we can take the lead. I think it would be a mistake for any council member to think they can take the lead over the administration. That just isn't the way our government works.
Okay, that's great. Well, that's it. Hopefully this wasn't a difficult interview for you. This is pretty good.
My wife says I don't smile enough.
You don't smile. Okay, well, we're going to both turn to the camera. We're going to both smile and say, thank you, Provo residents. This is George Stewart. You've known him for years. You may want to see him again. Let yourself make that voice when you go vote.
And I'll try to smile more.
All right. Thank you very much for watching.
Thank you, folks.